Hello, this is Charles Anderson doing another Aspen Custom Modeler ACM simulation demonstration. What I thought I'd do today is look at string sets and manipulating equations with string sets. It's a little bit complicated and sort of confused me the first few times I tried. And I started coding up a doozy the other day, so I thought it might be a good demonstration. So I was looking at the NRTL, the non-random two-liquid model for liquid non-ideality in mixtures. This is the basic equation, at least as coded by Aspen Plus. There's a few variations depending on which source you use. But you can see it's got various sums over various different arrays or the same array, but with different subsections for those arrays. There's multiple terms, which makes it kind of an interesting exercise to work through. What I did, because I have a loathing of divisions, creates divide by zero errors, and so I always try and get rid of divisions wherever I can when coding in ACM, is that I've recouched the basic NRTL model in this form. So log gamma is A1i plus the sum of A2i over j. A1 being this part of the original equation. And again, what I've done is I've multiplied through by the divisor to avoid divide by error. And then similarly, this whole mess here is A2. And what I've done is I've multiplied inside the bracket by that sum, which sort of moves that up to here. And then that gives me 2 or the sum over k twice. And so I move that over to the right hand side to get the sum over k squared equals that whole stuff. Moving that over into ACM. What I've done is I've created a local string set, local properties, and I use that to define all those arrays as necessary. The two big loops, the I is the key term for the gamma, so the first loop is on I, the second loop is on J, so these are macro level loops where I'm going to do multiple equations within each of those loops. And again, I'm saying for each I in the string set local properties. So it's going to say I is A and then I is water. So for a simple equation like alpha, that I can just use the array indices as expected. When I get to something like that A2 term, which if you remember had various sums in it, what I need to do is sum over K or sum over M inside of that ij loop. So in ACM, what I've done is I've used the sigma for each nomenclature or textural structure. So what I can say is essentially for each k in that array of local properties, and this k in local props has to be within parentheses, it then uses that k for the sigma function. So it's x1 g1j plus x2 g2j, and then that whole sigma term is squared on the left hand side. Similarly, inside I'm summing over k and summing over m, various other bits and pieces. And then once I've finished with the j loop, the a1 term, again I've got that sum over k and a sum over j to give me that value of ai, and then gamma I. Again, I'm avoiding using the log because log, although I am using it here, I've forced temperature to be non-negative, so the log isn't going to misbehave. In fact, it's non-zero. It can't be zero or negative. And so here, the gamma is going to work just fine. Okay, so that is sort of a high-level simple manipulation of the arrays. A couple of other tricks I thought I'd share while I was showing you this. If I actually create an instance where what I'm going to do is try and fit some data, so I've got, let's say, TXY data for a vapor liquid equilibrium, what I need to do is say, given a liquid composition and a temperature, calculate the boiling pressure and the vapor composition. Or some combination of that. So I've got an Antoine equation for the vapor pressure. I'm saying at the boiling point, the sum of the mole fraction times the activity coefficient times the vapor, the pure component vapor pressure. The sum of all those has to equal the overall pressure, and that's I can then force that to be the boiling pressure. So here you can see I'm using that sigma without doing the for each loop, but again, it's summing over each element of the local props. That is useful, and that sets me up. If I have a look at the model, though, you can see I'm setting the temperature and both liquid compositions, liquid phase molar fractions. Of course, I don't have that degree of freedom. Really, what I want to do is free one of these. So what I would normally do is create a string parameter called key that's named for one of these elements. And then I would free that, and I would force the sum of x's to equal 1. So if I compile that, I end up with the same model. It's still square. If I run, I get the same results. Bug in ACM that recreates those columns. That's just in ACM 11. They fixed it in ACM 12, I'm told. Okay. So that's nice, but the thing is I've now got to manually type in this water 2, and I've got to make sure I don't make a spelling error, or you know, if I make it water, then you'll see I'm overspecified because both of my x's are fixed and I've still got the sum in there. So that's not ideal. So what I can do is a lovely little trick that I spotted the other day in the Aspen Flash model. What I can do is I can create a parameter called valid components that uses string parameter as a variable type, and then I'm just going to say that it's valid as anything as a string set. I can then make my key, rather than a string parameter, I can make it valid comp. So it's still a string parameter, but it's got an extra constraint on it. It has to be an element of valid. I haven't defined what valid is yet, but if I come over here, what I can do is I can force valid to be the string set local properties. And so now key has to be an element of the local properties. So if I compile that model, you can see that now that key has to be either A or water 2. Unfortunately, it's not got an initial condition. I haven't given it a starting point. What I'd really like to do is force it to be one of those existing elements of the string set local properties. So what I can do is another little cheat. I can run through the array of local properties and set that value of key equal to the local property. And what it'll do is it'll start at the top of the list and go chunk, 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 chunk. And then the last one in the array will be what you end up having as your initial guess for key. Doing it this way, I force key to be a member of local properties. I could, of course, manually write it such that if I know what the name of the component is, it's good. But you can see now it's defaulted itself to water 2, and it's behaving nicely. So it's a nice way to force a string parameter to be an element of an existing array. So that's the vapor-liquid equilibrium piece. Now the last thing I was going to show you is, if I look at how I've coded up the structure, so I used a structure like I've described in previous videos to set up the NRTL parameters. That forces them to be the same everywhere in the model if I want them to, or I can set up separate regions of the model with the same structure in different regions if I get really keen. But usually I want the properties to be identical throughout the model. So if I look at the way I've got that set up, it's here under structures. So if I have a look at the elements of that structure, what have I done wrong? I want it out of here. So you see I've got all of the elements fixed all the way through the through there. In reality, I don't really want to manually put in the the elements where they're identical. I want to force those always to be zero, just because they have to be zero, because a pure component doesn't have non-ideality. So it would be nice if I could just make an equation to force those to be zero. And then similarly for the C term, that's actually symmetrical. And so Cij equals Cji. So I've manually set them to the same value here, but it would be nice if it forced that to happen automatically for C and the D term as well. So how can I do that? I had to scratch my head on this one. This is a bit of a clunky and ugly solution. So if you want to tune off here, this would be a good place to break. But if you're keen, we can push forward. What I've done is I've created three arrays. So I've created a string parameter or an array that is n components long of string parameters. So I'm going to have, instead of an array dimensioned on A and water, I'm going to have an array dimensioned 1, 2, and then the elements of 1 will be A and the element 2 will be water. To achieve that, I pull a similar trick to the way I initialized the key in the model I showed you last time. What I do is I come through for each of the local components. I make component 1, the first element, equal to local props minus I. So it's going to run through and set up comps 1 to be everything other than the last element. And then comps 2 is going to be everything other than the string set comps 1. So this will essentially be the last element of the array. I can then set up a loop where I go through elements 2 through n and force the comps 1 to be the array of everything that I haven't already got, and comps 2 then becomes the difference between the two, so that comps 2 ends up being a list of my elements. And then finally, I can flip that around to get my comp names, and then having done that, actually let me just demonstrate that quickly because I'm talking too much and it's probably easier to just see what's going on. So let's compile that. And what you can see is, so I've set up comps 1 to be everything except water. And then, comps 1 is A, comps 1 element 2 is nothing. So then comps 2 is everything in the local set, which is A1, A and water 2. So it ends up being just A, and the difference between A and that is a blank set. And so I'm not expressing myself well, but really what I've ended up doing is setting the system up such that I can have comps 1 is A, and comps 2 is water 2. If I add a third element in here, it might make it slightly clearer. So you can see now the model's broken because of it's not set up for that, but you can see comps 1 is comps 1 is A and B, water's been eliminated. Comps 2 is just A because B and water have been eliminated, and comps 3 is an empty set. So when I do comps 2, 1, that is local properties minus comps 1, 1. So it's water 2. Similarly, comps 2 is B, and comps 2, 3 is A. And then that's in the reverse order to my need to have it alphabetical. So I reverse that in comp names to get me A, B, and water 2. What that then lets me do is finally go through the numerical array. And if I equals J, I could do this with a string set. If they're equal, what I do is I free that element and then put an equation in to force it to zero. So for all the binaries with itself, I free the element and force it to zero. So you can see now A11 is zero, ABB is zero, and then AWater is zero. So that I could do with a string set, but what I couldn't do is this, which is to say, if I is greater than J, in other words, if I, so then free that element and set it equal to set ij equals to ji. So if I fixed C A B as 0.3, now C B A is free and it's going to be forced to be the same as C A B. Similarly, C B war, yeah. So those cross terms are now free, and by being able to compare the numerical size where it is in the array, that lets me put the top half of the top diagonal free and make the top half reflect the bottom half diagonal. And so that was a cute little trick that I thought I'd share. Okay, I've babbled on enough. I'm going to stop there. Thank you very much for listening.